बिस्मिल्लाह रहमान रहीम, अस्सलाम वालेकुम, कैसे हैं आप? दिस इज़ लेक्चर नंबर 8, लेट्स स्टार्ट। सो फर्स्ट वी टेक अ रिव्यू ऑफ प्रीवियस लेक्चर। इन लास्ट लेक्चर वी डिस्कस्ड हाउ टू क्रिएट डिफरेंट टाइप्स ऑफ चार्ट्स इन माइक्रोसॉफ्ट एक्सेल, एंड वी डिस्कस्ड हाउ टू क्रिएट हिस्टोग्राम्स एंड हाउ टू क्रिएट स्कैटर प्लॉट, एंड देन वी डिस्कस्ड हाउ टू यूज एक्सेल एडिंस, and in particular we discussed how to activate Excel add-ins and how to use data analysis tool pack, which is also an Excel add-in. And then we used this data analysis tool pack to construct histogram as well. In the later half of the previous lecture we discussed what are the measures of central tendency, and we discussed the characteristics of a good average or good central measure, and in particular we discussed that the first measure of central tendency, which is arithmetic mean or simply called mean. And then we discussed what are the basic methods which we can use to find the arithmetic mean for the ungrouped data as well as for the grouped data. So this was this is all which we discussed in our previous lecture. So let's start. So let us discuss the objectives of the current lecture. So in the current lecture we will again keep our focus on the measures of central tendency, and we will discuss the weighted arithmetic mean, or simply the weighted average or weighted mean, and then we will discuss how to combine different means to get a one single mean, that is mean of the means, which is called the combined arithmetic mean or simply combined mean. And then we will also discuss what are the merits and demerits of using arithmetic mean as a measure of central tendency. And then we will also discuss another measure of central tendency, which is the median, and we will discuss how to calculate median for the ungrouped data and how to calculate median for the grouped data. And we will also discuss the merits and demerits of this measure of central tendency as well. So first we discuss weighted arithmetic mean. In a data set, if some observations have more importance as compared to other observations, then taking simple average is misleading. So there are some observations having more weight but some other observations having less weight, then if you take simple average, just adding all the observations and dividing the sum by the total number of observation, you will get simple mean. But because the importance of observations is different, so it means this simple average will be misleading. So it means we need to incorporate all the weights as well. So in this case, the different weights are assigned to different observations according to their relative importance, and then the average is calculated by considering weights as well. So it means we have to consider the weights as well while calculating arithmetic mean. Otherwise, the average which is calculated by giving an equal weight to all the observations will be totally misleading. So that's why the concept of weighted arithmetic mean is introduced. So this average is called weighted arithmetic mean or simply the weighted mean, and this is usually denoted by X bar W. So W is written in the subscript. So now we discuss how to compute weighted arithmetic mean. So suppose we have n observations in a data set. X1 represents the first observation, X2 the second observation, and so on. We have xn, the nth observation. So for n observations, x1 to xn of a data set with corresponding weights w1, w2, and so on up to wn. So it means x1 has weight w1, x2 has weight w2, and so on, xn has weight wn. So in order to calculate weighted arithmetic mean, we will use this formula. X bar w is defined as summation wi xi, where I ranges from 1 to n, whole divided by summation wi, where I ranges from 1 to n. Or we can omit the subscripts, the range of the summation, which is I equals 1 to n, and we can simply write it as summation wi divided by summation w. Remember that here in this case x i's, they are the original observations, and w i's are the corresponding weights. So summation wx divided by summation w. So this is the formula which is used to calculate the weighted arithmetic mean. So let us consider an example. So calculate weighted arithmetic mean for the following data. So we have different items. In the first column of the table, the first item is food, second one is rent, third one is clothing, next one is fuel and light, and last one contains other items. In the second column, we have the expenditure in rupees, and we denote this expenditure by X. So for food, 290, and then for rent, 54, for clothing, 98, for fuel and light, we have 75, and for others, we have the same number, 75. So this is a hypothetical data. And then in the next column, we have the weights. So weights which are allocated to each of these items. So for the food, the weight is 7.5. For rent, the weight is 2. For clothing, the weight is 1.5. And for fuel and light, the weight is 1. And for other items, the weight is 0.5. So we denote weights by W here. So question is, we want to calculate weighted arithmetic mean for this data set. So from this data, we can see that we have the expenditure of different items, and we have their corresponding weights as well. So according to this formula, we have weighted arithmetic mean summation I is equal to 1 to n wi xi whole divided by summation I is equal to 1 to n summation wi. So this is equal to summation wx divided by summation w. So we can use this formula to calculate weighted arithmetic mean. So it means, just by looking at the formula, we can see that we need two things. First one is summation wx, and next one is summation w. So summation w is the sum of all weights. So it means just add all these weights, 7.5, and then 2, then 1.5, then 1, and then 0.5, we get summation w. And in order to calculate this numerator expression, which is summation wx, we have to multiply x with w to get a new column, which is wx, and then we have to add all the entries of this wx column to get summation wx. So once we have both expression, summation wx and summation w, we can divide the two expression to get the weighted arithmetic mean. So let us do the same calculation step by step. So first step, calculate the product xi wi. So it means we have to multiply this xi with wi to get a new column, which is the product of xi and wi. So because we are interested in finding this sum wi times xi, so for finding xi wi, multiply this 290, which is the first value, with 7.5. So 290 multiplied with 7.5, we get 2175. Then 54 multiplied with 2, we get 108. Then 98 multiplied with 1.5, we get 147. Then 75 multiplied with 1, we get the same number, 75. Then 75 with 0.5, we get 37.5. So this is how to calculate the new column, which is the product of x and w. So we labeled this column as xi wi. So once we have this xi wi product, we can add these observations to get this summation wx or summation wi xi, where I ranges from 1 to n. In this case, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 items. So n is 5 in this case. So once we have this part, then we can add all the weights, that is all the entries in this weight column, to get summation w. So summation w is obtained by adding all the entries in this second column. So this is summation wi, where range of summation starts from I equals 1 to n. So in next step, calculate summation w, which is sum of all weights. So 7.5 plus 2 plus 1.5 plus 1 and plus 0.5, we get 12.5. so sum of all these entries is summation w, which is 12.5. so this number is summation w. And similarly, calculate summation wx, which is sum of the product of w and x. So we have here wx. So if we add all the numbers here in this column, 2175, 108, 147, 75 and 37.5, we get 2542.5. so this is summation w times x. So once we have both numbers, summation w and summation wx, we can use this formula, which is summation wx over summation w, to calculate weighted arithmetic mean. So now we have all the entries, summation w here and summation wx here. So we can use this formula to calculate the weighted arithmetic mean. So just replace in this formula with their corresponding values. So summation wx, which is 2542.5. so in this case, just replace this summation wx by its value, which is 2542.5, and divide this number by summation w, which is 12.5. so once we divide these two numbers, we get 203.5. so the unit used is rupees, so the unit should be written as well. So it means the weighted arithmetic mean for this data is 203.5, or we can say that the average expenditure spent on all these items is 203.4 rupees. So this is how to calculate weighted arithmetic mean. So let us discuss combined arithmetic mean. So for k subgroups of data consisting of n1, n2 and so on, nk observations, with sum of these observations n1, n2 and so on nk, we get summation ni, where I ranges from 1 to k. So this is equal to n. So it means, if we add the number of observations in different subgroups, so the total number of observations in all the subgroups, so in first subgroup we have n1 observations, in second subgroup we have n2 observations, and in the kth subgroup we have nk observations. So it means the total observations of all the subgroups, that will be n1 plus n2 and so on nk. So this sum is written as summation ni, where I ranges from 1 to k. 1 is the starting number here and k is the last kth number. So this sum, it means sum of all observations n1 plus n2 and so on nk, we denote this by total observation, which is n. So we also have their respective arithmetic means. So the first subgroup containing n1 observations has arithmetic mean x1 bar. Similarly, the second subgroup containing n2 observations has arithmetic mean x2 bar, and so on. The kth subgroup having nk number of observations have arithmetic mean xk bar. So we have the number of observations in different subgroups as well as their arithmetic means. So we want to calculate the combined arithmetic mean, which is the mean of all k means. So in order to calculate combined arithmetic mean, we use this notation x bar c, where c stands for combined arithmetic mean. So x bar is the mean, c stands for combined mean. So it is n1 x1 bar plus n2 x2 bar and so on nk xk bar. So n1 is number of observation first subgroup, x1 bar is its corresponding arithmetic mean. Similarly, n2 number of observations in second subgroup, x2 bar its arithmetic mean, and so on up to nk into xk bar. And we divide this sum of products with n1 plus n2 and so on up to nk. So writing this expression, the expression in the numerator as well as the expression in the denominator in summation form, we can write it as summation ni xi bar, where I ranges from 1 to k, and this summation is denoted by summation ni, where I ranges from 1 to k. Note that it is very easy to write this expression in the summation form. So just look at this expression term by term. So in the first term we have n1 x1 bar, in second term we have n2 x2 bar, and last term nk xk bar. So only the subscripts are different in each term. So in first term we have the subscript 1, in second term we have the subscript 2, and so on in the kth term we have the subscript k, whereas the rest of the expressions is same. So we can denote this as summation ni xi bar, where I ranges from 1 to k. And similarly in the denominator, n1 plus n2 so on nk, we can write it as summation ni, where I ranges from 1 to k. So writing numerator expression as it is, and this denominator is sum of number of observations in each subgroup. So from this definition we can see that this number of observation is regarded as n. So just replace this by the total number of observation, which is n. So this is the formula for finding the combined arithmetic mean. So let us consider an example. So here let us consider an example. The mean height heights and the number of students in three sections of a statistics class are given below. So we have in the first column sections, section A, B and C. In the second column we have number of students. So in section A we have 40 students, in section B we have 37 students, in section C we have 43 students. And in the last column, third one, we have mean height in inches. So in section A, the average or the mean height of the students is 62 inches. Remember that this mean height is for the 40 students, because in section A there are a total of 40 students. In section B there are 37 students, and the average or mean height of these 37 students is 58. Similarly, in section C the total number of students are 43 and the mean or average height is 61. So we have this data containing number of students and their mean height in inches of three different sections. So question is, calculate overall or combined mean height of the students. So combined mean is also called the overall mean. So overall mean, we are interested in finding the combined mean. So note that in this data set we have number of students in first section, so we denote it as N1, so N1 is 40. Number of students in second section, we have 37 students, so N2 37. Number of students in third section is 43, so N3 is 43. And similarly, their mean height in first section, that is 62, so it means X1 bar is 62. Mean height in second section, X2 bar 58, and mean height in third section is 61, so X3 bar equals 61. So we have extracted this information from this given data, N1 and 2 and 3 and X1 bar, X2 bar and X3 bar. So we can use this formula to calculate the combined mean. So multiply N1 with X1 bar, so it means 40 multiplied with 62, then plus N2 X2 bar, 37 with 58, then plus N3 X3 bar, it means 43 with 61, and divide this sum of product with N1 plus N2 plus N3, it means 40 plus 37 plus 43. So when you will divide the resultant number in the numerator and the resultant number in the denominator, you will get the combined mean, which should be 60.4, and the unit should be in inches. So it means the combined mean for this data set is 60.4 inches. So this is how to calculate combined arithmetic mean. So let us discuss the merits of arithmetic mean using as a measure of central tendency. So first one is, it is easy to calculate and it is easy to understand. So from the formula we can see that X bar for ungrouped data is summation X over N. So we can calculate it quite easily, and we can also understand the idea of calculating arithmetic mean, that it is sum of observations divided by the number of observations. So the first merit of arithmetic mean is that it is easy to calculate as well as easy to understand. The second one is that it is based on all observations. So in the calculation of arithmetic mean, all the observations are used. So it means if there is any issue in any of the observations, then that will be depicted in the arithmetic mean. So arithmetic mean is based on all observations. So this is also the condition of a good average. So third one is that it can be expressed by a mathematical formula. Remember that a good average, an average is said to be a good average if it can be expressed by a mathematical formula. So since arithmetic mean has a mathematical representation, or it can be expressed by a mathematical formula, so it is also considered as a good average. So now we discuss some of the demerits of arithmetic mean. So first one is that it is greatly affected by extreme values. So remember that extreme values are also called outliers. So suppose we have some group of observations, suppose 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. So we can see that all the observations are quite close to each other. But instead of this data set, suppose we have another data set containing observations 1, 2, 3, 4 and last observation is, let's say, 100. So now in this case we can see that the last observation, which is 100, it is very far from the rest of the observations. So this observation, which is very far from the other group of observations, that is called the outlier. So this is also called the extreme values. So extreme values mean the unusual values. So here in this example, 100 is an unusual value which lies very far from the rest of the observations. So the demerit of arithmetic mean, one of the demerits is that it is greatly affected by the extreme values. So let us explain this idea with the help of an example. Suppose we have five numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and the average of these 5 numbers is sum of these numbers divided by 5. So 15 is the sum divided by 5, the average is 3. So now if we change the last number, which is 5, so if we replace this 5 by 20, so then the average of the new 5 numbers will be 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 plus 20 divided by 5, the mean is 6. So you can see that by changing one single number, that is 5, to 20, the average changes and it increases from 3 to 6. So but note that this 6 is not a representative number of this data set. So because most of the data, it means the first four number 1 2 3 4, they lie below this average. So it means this average is not the central point in this case, or in other words, it is not representing the behavior of all these 5 numbers. So it means if we have extreme value or an outlier in our data set, then the mean will be give us very wrong picture. So that is why it is said that the arithmetic mean is greatly affected by extreme values. So another demerit of arithmetic mean is that it works well only in case of symmetric distributions, and it performs very poorly in case of skewed distribution. So symmetric distributions mean equally spreaded. So we discussed last time that this bell shaped curve, it is a symmetric distribution, because around this mean value we have 50% on left hand side of this vertical line and 50% of observations on right hand side of this vertical line. So this symmetric distribution is the normal distribution. So if we consider another distribution, which is a uniform distribution, so uniform mean having same probability throughout. So uniform mean same probability, suppose 0.1 throughout for all the points. So This is again a symmetric distribution. We can subdivide it from the middle into two portions. But if we have, suppose, a skewed distribution is, so this is the right skewed. So now you can see that the arithmetic mean is not representing the data very well. So this is another demerit of using arithmetic mean as a measure of central tendency. So case of symmetric distribution, it works very well. But if the distribution is skewed or asymmetric, then we should not use arithmetic mean as a measure of central tendency for that particular data set. And next we will study that in that case, the second measure which is which works well is the median in case of, so median should be used in case of skewed distribution or asymmetric distributions. But arithmetic mean should be used in only in case of symmetric distributions. So another advantage is that arithmetic mean is misleading in bipolar cases, or bipolar case misrepresented. For example, in a class 50% of the students, they got full marks in a certain quiz, so it means 100 out of 100, and the remaining 50% of the students, they got 0 marks, it means 0 out of 100. So you can see that if we plot the distribution of the class of these marks of these students, so it will be one peak at 0 and then another peak will be at 100. So suppose here is the 0 and here we have 100. So it is called the bimodal data. So you can see that here, if you take the average of the students, marks of the students, so the average will be somewhat here. So it means this average is saying that overall class performance is 50%, or it is the class is performing satisfactory. So but actually what is the case, that 50% of the students they understood nothing, and the remaining 50% of the students they understood everything. So but the arithmetic mean that will show that overall class performance is good. So but this is not true in this case. So bipolar case, so we have two poles here. So bipolar case is usually misrepresented. So if we have data of such a such type, then we should not use arithmetic mean. So it means arithmetic mean cannot be used, or it does not show the correct picture when the data is in bipolar form. So next demerit is if the grouped data has open-ended classes, so then arithmetic mean cannot be calculated without assuming the limits. So suppose in a grouped data we have classes, so suppose 70 and more. So 70 and more. So we cannot calculate arithmetic mean because we don't know the upper limit. So it means we have to specify this number 70 to 80 or 70 to 90. So why? Because we need to calculate the midpoints. So midpoint will not be able to, we will not be able to calculate the midpoint because the upper limit is not available in this case. So we have to replace this by certain assumed limit. So you can put here 80, 90, etc. So according to your data. So this is another demerit of arithmetic mean. So another demerit of using arithmetic mean as a measure of central tendency is Another demerit of using arithmetic mean as a measure of central tendency is the case of high growth and the increasing poverty. So in order to explain this idea, let us consider this data set. So here we have the data on 10 individuals. So individual number 1 to 10 and their income. So and note that out of these 10 individuals, 9 are poor, having income 10,000. So first individual has income 10,000, second one also has income 10,000, and so on. The ninth one has the same income 10,000. So it means 9 are the poor individuals with income 10,000 rupees, and the last one, the 10th one, is very rich with income 100,000 rupees. So the 10th individual has income 100,000. So if we take the average, so the average is sum of these income of these 10 individuals divided by 10, so it is 19,000. But if we double the income of rich individual, the only one individual in this data set, the last one, the 10th individual, if we double the income of this individual from 100,000 to 200,000, and at the same time reducing the income of poor by half, so from 10,000 to 5,000, so from 10,000 to 5,000, so you can see that after this adjustment, the 9 individuals who were earning 10,000 rupees previously, so in the new scenario, their income is reduced by half from 10,000 to 5,000. It means they become more poor. So, but one individual, the last one, 10th individual, his income increased by 100,000. So it means his income got doubled, so his income becomes 200,000. So you can see that the rich individual becomes more rich, and the poor individuals, they got more poor. So if we take the average of this new data set, the average is 24,500. So if we only compare these two numbers, so we can see that overall the average of this new data set has increased. So if we look only at the average, we will say that yes, there is a high growth. So there is high growth. Why? Because average is increased from 19,000 to 24,500. But actually what happened, that the poor individuals, they got more poor, whereas the rich individual has doubled his income. So it means the increasing poverty and the high growth. This is the case where the politicians usually deceive people, and they say that in their regime growth was very high, but actually the poverty prevailed in their regime. So it means we have to be very careful while using arithmetic mean as a measure of central tendency. So people use this arithmetic mean, or simply the average, to deceive people. So while doing statistics, so please be aware of these tricks. So this is very important to learn. So be careful while doing statistics. So now we discuss another measure of central tendency, which is called median. So median divides the arranged data, which is arranged either in ascending order, ascending mean from lower number to higher number, or in descending order, descending mean from higher to lower number. So it divides the arranged data, arranged in any order, into two equal parts, in such a way that 50% of the data lies before the median value, and the remaining 50% of the data lies above the median value. So it means median is the middle point. So just arrange the data and locate the middle value, which divides the data into two equal parts. So median, if median lies here, so it means this cutoff point indicates that before this 50% of the data value lies, and after this the remaining 50% of the data lies. So suppose we have five numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So we can see that the number 3, it lies exactly in the middle of these five numbers. So before 3 we have two numbers, 1 and 2, and after 3 we have again the two numbers, 4 and 5. So in this case 3 will be considered as a median. So but if we have even number of observations, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, so we can see that here the observed median, it will be between the third and fourth observations. So between third and fourth observations there will be median. So before median we will have in this case the first three numbers, 1, 2, 3, and after median we will have the remaining three numbers, 4, 5, 6. So if we have even number of observations in a data set, then the median will be the average of middle two numbers. But remember that you have to first arrange the data set. But if you have the odd number of observation in a data set, so then simply arrange the data set and pick the middle number. So this is how median is calculated. So remember that median is also called the positional average. So whereas arithmetic mean is called the mathematical average. So let us discuss how to calculate median for the ungrouped data. So calculating median for the ungrouped data. So in first step, arrange the data in either ascending order or in descending order. So usually data is arranged in ascending order, that is from smallest value to the largest value. So in second step, compute an index I, which is defined as I equals n by 2, where n is the total number of observations in a data set of which we want to calculate the median. So next, after calculating this index I, note that if I is an integer or I is not an integer. So remember that integers are the values, are the simple numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 without decimal points. So if I is not an integer, suppose I is 10.2, 9.3, so it is some decimal number. So suppose it is 7.2, so then round up. The next integer greater than I denotes the position of the median. So suppose the calculated index I is 7.2, so the next integer greater than I, it means 7.2, the next integer is 8. So 8 will denote the position of the median. But if I is an integer, so then the median will be the average value, average of the values in position I and I plus 1. So suppose I is calculated to be 7. Now note that 7 is an integer. So if 7 is an integer, so then the median will be calculated by taking the average of the values in position number I, which is 7, and the position I plus 1, it means 7 plus 1. So at position 7 and 7 plus 1, it means 8th. So 7th and 8th position. So if we take the average of the values which occur in position number 7 and in position number 8, we will get the median. So let us explain this idea with the help of an example. So let us consider an example of calculating median for the ungrouped data. So we have here marks obtained by 5 students, 20, 15, 3, 25 and 10. So in order to calculate median of median marks of 5 students, the solution is, in first step, arrange the data in ascending order, 3, 10, 15, 20 and 25. So once we have data in arranged form, next step is to compute the index I, which is defined as I equals n by 2, where n is the total number of observations. In this case, the total number of observations are 5. So to compute index I equals to n by 2, so it means 5 divided by 2, which is 2.5. Next check, note that I is 2.5, it is not an integer. So if it is not an integer, so then the next integer greater than this value, that is 2.5, is 3. So next integer is 3, which gives the position of the median. So at third position we have number 15. At first position we have number 3, at second position we have number 10, and at third position we have number 15. So the median is the number at third position. So at third position we have number 15, so it means the median is 15. So another way to calculate median is just arrange the data and locate the middle number, which is the 15. So two numbers, 3 and 10, they occur before the median value, and the next two numbers, 20 and 25, they occur after the median number. So median is the middle value. But this procedure, that is first compute index and check whether it is integer or it is not an integer. So this is more suitable when we have a large number of observations. So next we consider another example to calculate median for the ungrouped data. So runs made by a cricket player in 4 matches. So 30, 70, 10 and 20. We are interested in calculating median of the score. So the solution is, in first step, arrange the data in ascending order, 10, 20, 30 and 70. So then in next step, compute the index I equals to n by 2, where n is the total number of observations. In our case we have 4 observations, so n will be 4 in our case. So the index is calculated as 4 by 2, which is 2. So note that in this case the index is 2, which is an integer. So it means the median is the average of the values in position I and I plus 3. So I is 2, so it means at position 2 and 2 plus 1. So I and I plus 1, so I is 2 and then 2 plus 1, it means 3. So it means the median is the average of the values in position 2 and 3. So at position number 2 we have number 20, and at position number 3 we have number 30. So it means the median is the average of these two middle values. So average of 20 and 30 can be calculated by adding these two numbers, 20 and 30, and then dividing this average, this sum, by 2. So 50 divided by 2, we get 25. So in this case the median is 25. So this is how to calculate median for the ungrouped data. Let us review the main concepts which we discussed in today's lecture. So in today's session we discussed the measures of central tendency, we discussed weighted arithmetic mean, or simply weighted mean, and we discussed how to find combined or overall arithmetic mean, and then we discussed merits and demerits of arithmetic mean, and then we also discussed, we have discussed what are the in which situations where we should not use arithmetic mean and how people use arithmetic mean to deceive other people. So be careful while using arithmetic mean as a measure of central tendency. And then we discussed median, and we discussed the how to calculate median for the ungrouped data. In next lecture we will discuss how to calculate median for the grouped data and the merits and demerits of using median as a measure of central tendency. We will also discuss another measure of central tendency, which is the mode. We will also discuss how to calculate mode for the grouped data and how to calculate mode for the ungrouped data. We will also discuss the merits and demerits of using mode as a measure of central tendency. We will also discuss another measure of central tendency, that is geometric mean. So we will discuss different methods for calculating geometric mean for the ungrouped data as well as for the grouped data. And we will also discuss the merits and demerits of using geometric mean as a measure of central tendency. So till then, Allah Hafiz.